As of April 18th Sunday, a step to further destabilize Eastern Mediterranean, Greece signed a record defense deal with Israel, a defense procurement deal which includes about 1.65 billion worth of contract for the establishment operation of training center for Hellenistic Air Force by Israel Defense. So as I mentioned, it is heightening the already tense environment in the region and seemingly over hydrocarbon discoveries, and which were destined to export to EU energy markets. So before moving on, we should be underlining the fact that energy in terms of hydrocarbon security is not the existential threat for those countries. What we have as existential threat, climate change, as Paris Agreement has already attested, sustainable development goals, is 17 variety of its related goals, has already mentioned, one of them is directly related with Climate Act, attested, we have this existential threat of climate change. And this is indeed, in a broader scale, conceptualized and turned out to be the name of the Human Development Report. The concept is Anthropocene, denotes that the scale of humans' activities transforming the nature points to the fact that we are now in a new geologic age, the Anthropocene. So in the face of pressures triggering by environmental degradation, and in particular, as I mentioned, climate change, and it necessitates us to rethink about the way that we define energy and define our security. So as I mentioned, in Paris in 2015 and approved by 195 countries, the Paris Agreement has highlighted that we need to go beyond, well, below 2 degrees Celsius at the end of century, and all efforts to limit the rise of temperatures to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So in this parallel, states pledge to decrease their carbon emissions level, which is one of the main greenhouse gases that is responsible for climate change. But to open a parenthesis, Turkey is one of the few countries who did not approve climate change up until now. So along with climate change, as I mentioned, Anthropocene, which turned out to be the title of Human Development Index, most recently published last year. And it denotes that, as I mentioned, for the first time, it was indicated in the report that in our history, the most serious and immediate and even existential that Human Development Report highlights, risks are human-made and unfolding at planetary scale. And this new reality calls for reimagining the human development journey and leveraging the human development to support transformational social changes to ease pressures on the planet. So with that quotation from Human Development Report, it emphasizes that there are two ways now. We are in a crossroads. One way is to make a change, come out with a new path of development and decrease our pressures on planet, or business as usual, and it will be end of our planet, that we know it. And so it is basically up to us to change that trajectory. And this is directly related with the way that we consume our energy, that we produce our energy. And this requires us to make a shift in our dominant energy utilization forms, which is labeled as this. So we need to harness a transition towards a sustainable energy regime. So what we understand from energy system is actually a transition, is a change in the dominant composition of energy sources. So up until now, we used to have a coal age before we had wood, coal age, Then coal, as you know, as we know, is the fuel of industrial age. Then oil, in the turn of century from 19th to 20th century, made its mark and turned out to be the leading source in 1940s onwards. And now we are in a, now to try, and natural gas is at the moment considered as a transition fuel. We see the rise of natural gas and alternative energies, particularly following 1970s as a reaction to OPEC's oil crisis. And people at that time realized that oil is no more cheap and easily accessible. That ignited a paradigm shift in a sense that they have begun to invest heavily on alternatives, including nuclear. Now we are in a crossroads, as Anthropocene has mentioned. And what we know is that there is actually a natural pattern towards hydrogen. So why hydrogen? Because we see that through time, those resources with carbon intense has been utilized first, coal, then we shift to oil. Now the portion of carbon has declined and hydrogen increased. And the ultimate level that we can reach is hydrogen, the very source of sun. So there's a, as I mentioned, there's a natural trend towards that. And there is no way to escape from that. What you can do is, of course, slow the pace of this transition to utilization of that source, more efficient, more clean energy. But there's no way to stop that. So at the current stage, still about more than 70% we rely on hydrocarbons, oil, coal, and natural gas. Sometimes people refer natural gas as innocent, but it also includes methane. And it is, again, one of those greenhouse gases, and which impact is much more than carbon emissions. The good news is that following 2000s, we see an incrementally increasing share of renewable energy, apart from non-hydro. At the current stage, we know that various countries has managed to increase the portion of their non-hydro energy, but still a lot of way to go. Most recently, Amber think tank in London, I have come out across with their findings, and they have been emphasizing that Turkey, in let's say, in last 5 years, has managed to increase the share of wind and solar, non-hydro, wind and solar about 7% and reaches to the level of 12% of electric generation. It's an important success, but of course, for the purposes of addressing climate change, it is still not enough. And we should also bear in mind that Turkey, let's say, still continue to provide subsidies to coal, and still coal had made about 50% of increase in that period as well. So in order to make that energy transition, of course, the priority is supposed to be those green energies, not coal, and coal is the largest emitter of carbon emissions. According to International Energy Agency, let's say, they are considering that incrementally increasing volume of shares. They says that they declared that in 2025, they expect that renewables, of course, the lion's share is still hydrocarbon, will surpass coal. So that's a good news, but of course we need, it seems that they need to work more on renewables. So what could be the drivers when we look at the drivers of that energy transition? Of course, technology and price. These are two important drivers for this energy transition towards sustainable one. But of course, in order for them to be materialized, to be realized, the role of state is key. So energy governance is quite important. So how a given state defines energy security is quite important. So you may raise the question, what is energy security? Before giving you a well-known definition of energy security, I need to emphasize that it is very difficult to come up with a single comprehensive energy security because there are a variety of dimensions of energy security. So one of the well-known and highly utilized one is frequently referred monies comes from International Energy Agency. So International Energy Agency founded following as a reaction to OPEC. It's the club of importers and to coordinate their activities to ensure their energy securities. And the way International Energy Agency defines energy security is that uninterrupted availability of energy sources at an affordable price. Uninterrupted availability of energy sources at an affordable price. So here, of course, as I mentioned, this organization is importers organization. So the definition they rely on is basically addressing their needs. But of course, there are ambiguities that we need to bear in mind as well. So here, what we understand from which type of energy sources we should think about is not clear here. And what do we mean by affordable is not clear here. So if we just look through a managerial perspective by neglecting those negative externalities environment, would it make it affordable if we solely rely on coal? So if you look through, let's say, an environmental perspective, no. So we should be always think through a variety of dimensions before coming out with a comprehensive energy definition. And we should bear in mind that there are a variety of dimensions to bear in mind. Variety of questions that we need to answer in order to come out with that comprehensive definition. Like this ideal circle, it is quite difficult to come out with one. So, but there are a variety of questions that we need to bear in mind. So why and for whom energy is a security issue that we need to be clarify on that. Depending on you, who you ask, of course, we'll give you a different referent object. So that will change the definition. So in the case of International Energy Agency, the referent object is, of course, those energy importer countries who rely on, who are dire need of energy supplies to fuel their growth levels. So how to address energy security? There's no single answer to that question, of course. There are a variety of techniques that states utilize. Some of them utilize their gunboat diplomacy. Some of them utilize their liberal markets. Some of them rely on energy diplomacy. Some of them invest in heavily on R&D technologies, their R&D, to utilize their potential renewable energy sources. And of course, the critical question at the age of Anthropocene that states have been expected to raise is that should environmental concerns, such as climate change, of course, it is not limited to climate change, be included in energy considerations. So here at this point, there are three approaches to define energy security. So we can have those lenses that we can define energy security. So one of the lens that states utilize to define energy security and in return they transform into their foreign energy policies is this geopolitical approach. So in that geopolitical approach, the prior and just like mercantilism, you can, there are similarities. So you rely on energy dependence. You rely on, in that case, being independent. You don't want to be dependent on others' choices. You don't want to rely on other countries' sources. You would like to have energy interdependency. So for state security. So if you don't have this security, in that sense, so it is up to your military forces, and it is also up to your alliances structures that will ensure your energy security. But of course, the problem is all the time, you can't know for sure from a critical security perspective, sure, there's no total security. Okay, you always have the sense that insecurity in that regard. So the second, and this talk is supposed to be on Eastern Mediterranean. When you look at, to Eastern Mediterranean region energy tensions from that perspective, geopolitics But not those two other approaches, economic liberal market environment is the dominant one, but not the others. So economic wise, this liberal market model could also be adopted by actors. But indeed, let's say when there occurred these discoveries, the first discoveries in Eastern Mediterranean in late 2000s and early 2010s, what we have this optimistic scenarios through functionalist theories. Some pundits has proposed that by utilizing those reserves, they could be last window of opportunity by having interdependence, by, you know, coming out with joint projects of developments, and also coming out with various peace pipelines, let's say, a pipeline that comes from Cyprus to Ceyhan, which would be the most feasible option they propose. It also enable, will serve as a catalyst to bring peace to that region. But up until recently, due to the dominant geopolitical culture or narrative that we have in the region, we did not see that peace pipeline to be materialized. On the contrary, what we have seen, is that energy discoveries and prospective transportation routes, and which was this East-West pipeline, let's say, which was one of the main tensions between Turkey and other little states. And most recently, they have come up with East-Med Forum as well. And that pipeline is also supported by European Union, which I will be mentioning later on, who proposed most recently Green Deal, so green transformation, who supported that hydrocarbon project at the expense of environmental degradation. On the one hand, on the other hand, furthering tension in the geopolitical tension in the region. And EU, as I mentioned, considered it as a common project of common interest. So further destabilize the region. But East Mediterranean project is also a project that has limited prospect to be materialized. So particularly at the time of pandemic, as the price, there are shrinking energy prices. And at the time that, as I mentioned, both European Union come out with that Green Deal, and also Biden's US came out with this vision of, according to some label, by giving the reference to Roosevelt, new Green Deal, by referring to New Deal of Roosevelt. So when we have this energy transition towards more sustainable sources, it is in this regard quite paradoxical for European Union to turn a green light on that project. So as I mentioned, there are geopolitical, which is referring objective state security, mainly sovereignty over energy resources, and also and transportation routes. And the second one is economic liberal and market, leave it to the market. So interdependencies is the key. And referent object here in that case is economy. And third approach is environmental, which is actually adopted by European Union. And at the moment, along with, it's debatable to what extent the referent object is environment, but to what extent it is an economic, there's a thin line over there. But it is for sure that the European Union has combined those two considerations together while formulating its Green Deal, and it lays down EU growth policy framework to be adopted in the coming years with the aim to become carbon neutral in 2050. So the idea is to decoupling carbon from growth. So no more, there will be positive correlation, but they will be decoupling carbon from that. So in that regard, they consider as a tool to revive European economy in the pandemic and afterwards, and building a green economic model. So as I mentioned earlier again, Biden's US is also has come out with a huge package, $1.9 trillion package, to revive American economy based on, again, green growth. So it seems that these two prominent actors have been harnessing the transition towards sustainable energy regime. So, and for our purposes for Turkey, particularly the European Union's decision is quite important economic wise in the short period, because they are coming out with carbon tax. And most recently, they published a report by TÜSİAD. One of the authors is Erin Çeldan Hoca. They calculated this impact, direct impact on a variety of carbon-intense sectors in Turkey. So alarm bells are ringing for carbon-intense sectors in Turkey. And Turkey should urgently, in that regard, to take steps to transform its economy in a manner to adjust this Green Deal so that Turkey's economy would not lose its competitive power. So apart from that transformation will also enable, would like to enable Turkey to focus more on renewable energy development on its own. And of course, EU by this border tax is could be a important factor for transforming Turkish economy. But also EU could be a game changer in Eastern Mediterranean as well, by putting pressure on, by not pressure, but by shaping their structure in a way those, let's say, Greece and Republic of Cyprus that Turkey could not recognize, Greek Cypriot, to take steps on the way of renewable energy developments, rather than coming out with joint projects with Turkey, so that in line with this Green Deal, the EU can be a much more effective actor and also enable those countries to cooperate and come up with renewable energy transition that will harness their renewable energy transition, which would be in line with its EU Green Deal.